Hi dear friend, welcome in today's video. We are going to talk about Jia today. Jia means both family and clan, and we're going to explain what it means in Chinese culture and what it actually means for Chinese medicine Kung Fu and how it is being put out of context in many ways in Western culture. And my first discovery on this field was when I was doing research in Beijing, and I was doing an anthropological research into con men, or mostly women, in Beijing, who are selling art and tea to innocent foreigners, and they address them in all kind of ways. They bring them to all kind of places and they overpay for basically, well, cheap services to earn a lot of money. At the time, I had a lot of fun with this because I met a lot of people, seen a lot of places, didn't have to spend any RMB, and I got to know a lot about the tourist industry of Beijing. I saw the same schemes going on in other cities, but Beijing was most developed, and I got a really very good friend, which I have had a lot of fun from. Because of the information she could give me for a long time. There is this hierarchy in Chinese con world, and I discovered a few things because of that. One of the things had to do with the way how tong, which are communities or clans, are being organized, and the other one is that the tong is similar to the jia, other than that the tong usually is a little bit more, you know, less family based, but it follows basically the same rules. And also I found out that what we consider family doesn't really count for Chinese. For instance, we know two genders, men, male and female, and for China there are three genders. One is a father, one is a mother, and one is child. And these three genders, they are really very specific, because of course you have a male and a female child, but as long as you do not have your own family, you are just a child. And at the moment when you start having your own family, you become a man or you become a woman. To understand this, I have taken this topic into two parts. This part today, we are going to talk about family in general. And like I already said before, the word Jia, the character for Jia, means both family and clan. And we are going to go into this.
We have to ask ourselves a few questions.
Should talk about the Jia Ting. No, it's not the same like Jia Ting. When we talk about Jia Ting, we talk basically about a family who is like a group of partakers in a gradual, no, in a joint possession of land, property, or estate. The clan usually has shared bloodlines, and these shared bloodlines of course have adopted children, but they also have of course the wives who are married with the sons of the family. These jias, they also come in different levels, and we're going to talk about a little bit the history and the development of these jias in general. We can say of course that there is a difference in the jia before modernism and of course nowadays. When we talk about nowadays, we talk about the Chinese culture as it developed from, well, the late 19th century to this modern time. But the experience of Jia is still very much the same throughout all Chinese communities in China, Taiwan, Indonesia, Singapore, and so on. I remember a friend of mine said, like, well, you would never become my boyfriend because my family wouldn't accept you, because as a Jia we have a particular kind of rules, and that means that you cannot enter in our Jia, you cannot enter in our family. For the simple reason that she was supposed to enter my family. Confucianism is in favor of a society as an extended family. That means that society as a whole is seen as a bunch of families, and these families, they are intertwined in a particular kind of way, and they are basically the state. So that means that the royal family is an extended family which contains all the people of China. That means, considering the way how the Jia works, the Jia Ting works, everybody basically has to obey the patriarch. That's the emperor. The emperor is the super patriarch, Superman of China. And it is still like that. The Chinese culture, nationalism, culturalism, and so on, they all work on the basic premise that the one on the top is the family head, and everybody else are just family members, and they have to follow. People always consider Chinese culture to be an agricultural society. I personally disagree with that. I do see there's a lot of agriculture in China, but the majority of people, no, a majority of people, the ones who actually make up China, these are living in cities, and the agricultural people are basically sort of peripheral area. You can compare that a little bit with the Wild West in the United States, in the sense that the original people of China, what we nowadays call the Han people, they gradually moved south from the north, and they gradually enculturated parts of China, becoming more Han, and they did so by buying property from the minorities or just stealing it from them. It's the similar way, similar story, like how the United States was being created and how many other areas are being colonized or invaded or gradually taken over by other cultures. Like, for instance, the people who were chased away from the south, they moved further into Burma and so on, and gradually they overtook the population of area like Indonesia. We can say like that, like, okay, so Chinese society actually is a city-based society. It's something that is already mentioned in the Huang Yejing, like, because people have all kinds of desires, they live in cities and they want all kinds of things. The agricultural model, which is, for instance, proposed in the Tao Te Ching, at the last chapter of the Tao Te Ching, shows that the Confucianism as it proposes itself, like Laoism, are focused on the peripheral areas of the Chinese culture. So the family structure is based on the agricultural idea, while in fact the society itself is a city culture, and as a result of that, the estate management was a very important part. You have to understand that in the Chinese culture, when you talk about agricultural climate, we talk about a slash and burn culture, and it's something that is relatively unique to the Chinese culture in the way it's how it is being done. It means that, you know, you take a piece of land, you slash and burn all the plants on it, and you gradually start growing your stuff, and after a few years you have exhausted it, and as a result that you go to another place. And that is actually the real motivation why the Han people gradually moved south, because they were always burning their ships behind them. You can still see that in the modern Chinese culture, where there is this continuous mentality in the way how industry is going forward, how modernization is going forward. It is a sort of slash and burn quality. And you can see that in many other ways also, like, for instance, in the way how people set up a company, they live it out, and then they move to another place. They sell it to another company, which, you know, exploits it until they cannot handle it anymore, then it's being sold to another company, and so on. I remember meeting this friend in Wuhan. He had a very big, nice hotel, and was like, oh yeah, this is a very nice hotel, very beautiful. And then he said, yeah, the hotel next door was also mine, and the hotel next door was also mine. That's the hotel where I started. So he just moved his hotel a little bit sideways, and we went to visit the other hotels. And the other hotels, they were, you know, every hotel you go a little bit more south, so to say, they were more grubby, is the right word. The carpets were less clean and then more broken and so on. In Shanghai, nice example, you have this one big shopping road, and where is the warehouse 666, very famous in Shanghai. I forget for a moment out of my head what is the name of the street. I think, but I'm not exactly sure. But anyway, the 666, they sell very exclusive fashions. The same fashions are being sold in the warehouse before. That was the high class warehouse before 666 was opened. But now it is being occupied by the lesser brands, and there's still a few exclusive brands in there that haven't moved. But in general, you can say, okay, it is definitely of a lesser quality. It is also less rich in its dressing and so on and so on. But then next door to that, there is another warehouse where this warehouse actually originally started. And these are like the dumping brands. They have the same brands, but you know, something that costs in one shop €1,000 or $1,000 would cost only like a few euros or dollars in that shop. But they come from the same factory, like the Armani suits, they come from the same factory to be making the suits. They cost about €25. And when they're being sold, of course, they're sold for a big price. But then in this place, you would buy an Armani suit for, say, $150, while in the other one, you would pay like $2,000 for it. When you would go to the cloth market where they make them, the factory where they make them, you would buy them for $50 or $60. Of course, you have to know your way around. Unfortunately, I was for a while related with a fashion designer who told me exactly where to go for these kind of things. Nowadays, I don't live in Shanghai anymore, so I can't use that kind of benefit. When you look at the agricultural method of slashing and burning the land, the land that is being left behind is basically useless land. We talk very often about China, the northwestern and the northern areas, that they are so much dry and dusty and desertified, and that is because of the way how the Han people actually use the land. So this desert is not like a natural desert, but it is the result of the agricultural activities of the Chinese themselves. It's interesting to see, because in the family structure of Chinese culture, you see that as a result of that, families move. They are not really fixed to a particular kind of area, but they are semi-nomadic, you can say. Even though they buy or they build beautiful estates, after a couple of times their estate is being extended so much that they actually have to move, or maybe they create a dependance somewhere, or they conquer pieces and then they rent it out to other people to work it and to take the produce from that and to take some benefit. Then you see that the Jia or the Jia Ting, they have three different kind of peripheries. One is nature, one is the neighboring countries, and the third one is the leftover people from the different kind of families. I have to explain this a little bit. Because in Chinese military and in the business culture and economically, you can say that there are like the upper class, the government class, there is the Jia Ting culture where all the ownership is, and these Jia Ting, they create people who do not become owner, and these are the leftover people, which Mr. Ma from sales company. Why can I forget these kind of names? Anyway, these Mr. Ma, he called them the Ma'i, the ant people. And this is basically also the name that we nowadays use for these people. And I remember meeting one person. I go with her to her house. It took me some time to convince her that for my research was very important to see her house. And she lived in a boiler room under an apartment building where she was having at least warmth in the winter, but she had her clothing piled up on the floor to sleep on her clothing. This was basically her house. And sometimes she would sleep with friends, so she would have the feeling like she would be in a real house. She had a family who had an estate in another city, and she was kind of hoping that because of her work in Beijing, she would be able to create a better future for her family in general. When you look in China right now, you can see there is still also these reality even in mobile apps. You can see, for instance, an app like Shuiguo, which is basically a farmer's market, where farmers in the third and fourth tier cities, they offer their produce. You can buy them online, and then you can pick up oranges or other fruits or vegetables or something like this. But there's also another app called Douyin, and there's other ones like that. And they are more focused towards fashion things. And then there is Weixin, which of course is very famous already in the West. Not huge yet, but these are more based on family and life things. And it means, like, for instance, my family also we use Weixin to keep track of our friends and family, while we use, for instance, TikTok to produce things. And there's other apps like that. And Douyin is also one. What I can conclude for this for you is that the life in China was actually separated in two parts. That's the city part, that was the state part, and the life of settlers, this Wild West area. So life in China in general was very hard. And many were of the Mayi, what we now call the Mayi, the leftover people, they were continuously exploited and threatened, and their life was actually the hardest. But as a result of that, they did not develop this idea of self-reliance as we did in the West, where we developed things like the survivalists, the do-it-yourself culture from the 1970s and 80s, and the autonomous movements of the squatter movement. All these kind of things, they were all very different. They developed more what is called a idea of group reliance. And group reliance in that sense, is very different, because this group reliance creates possibilities that individual reliance does not have. For instance, so they developed options for defense so that they would be safe, that they could together clear the land, and that they could work the land together and get produce. I remember when I was living on a farm, then the whole village would run out to do the harvest, and they would share the income, and they would separate the harvest depending on who was the land, and then every family would get a little bit of the produce so that everybody would be able to sell something for the work and the help that they give to each other. And then so the whole year through, everything was basically organized like that. And they would also be able to fortify the community in the sense of maybe building fences or doing defensive things, learning martial arts, like you see in the warlord families, what we call the warlord families, which were basically clans, Jiating, which gradually turned into Pai when they started including all kind of people. And that is the reason why when you would become part of Pai, or you would become part of Jiating, you would actually become adopted as a child, as a son, usually because girls were not allowed to participate in their training. And you can see that this still also this clan mentality is in there, because when you become an adopted person, you remain basically on the lower level of the family, and as a result of that, you are basically demanded to contribute to the family without necessarily having the opportunity to develop your own self-reliance or your own, which can be very difficult for a foreigner to accept. It's why many foreigners, they try to find their own way. And I also had several issues with that within the Udang Xuanwu Pai, because I was also asked in the same way to surrender myself to the clan, and as a result of that, give up my own things so that I could do that, and then I would basically be able to gradually go up. And I could see with all my Chinese teachers that wherever they had this clan mentality, this clan organization, as a non-family member, not bloodline family member, is very difficult to climb up to a position of importance other than somebody who is feeding the family. And as a Westerner, that is very hard. And it's also very different where, for instance, nowadays we are asked by our governments to take care of our elderly family members because they want to reduce the spending from the government to healthcare, while they keep on spending on subsidizing big companies or allowing them not to pay any taxes. Well, we have to keep on paying taxes for the purpose of actually fortifying our society. Because this is the basic idea of all societies, is that joined, combined, we actually help ourselves by helping each other. And the whole idea of democracy, of anarchy, of communism, of any kind of other movement is based on that, except movements like neoliberalism and liberalism, capitalism and consumerism, which are all based on the self-gratification of a person who owns a lot. And that causes, of course, this disruption where you...
Another one, then. This is another one. You also do another one then.
Yeah.